In the tradition of great brother combinations, we have had, you know, great names like the Ho brothers, the Carroll brothers, and just recently we had the Tice brothers on. We've got another great brother combination here, the Slater brothers, all the way from Florida. And they're two of the hottest young amateur surfers in the world today. And they've just got back from a great trip to Australia where they represented the USA in a great contest down there. Welcome to the show, guys.
It's what?
I'll start off with Kelly. We won't go with the big brother first. We'll go to little brother. Kelly, how was Australia for the first time? Did you get some great waves down there?
We got great waves, super good trip.
And, you know, were you down there, you were with the USA team, you surfed against the Aussies, how did it go?
We did all right. We lost the team thing, but I placed first in the men's and the juniors.
How many more years do you think you're going to surf in amateur competition before you turn pro? I mean, everyone seems to be asking that already.
I'll probably wait till after high school. It'll be about 4 or 5 years, maybe.
So you got a lot more titles to win yet.
Well, hope so.
Let's talk to Sean for a moment. Sean, we were talking a little earlier today, and you were saying you got Kira down there, some of the best waves you've ever seen in your life.
Yeah.
How big was it?
It was about 6 feet.
Did you get some of those long barrels, you know, that you see on the movies all the time?
Yeah, average about two a wave.
Do you guys help each other out, you know, when you're at contests? I mean, you kind of coach each other?
Yeah, we sit on the beach and watch each other's heats and tell each other what we did wrong and right out in the heat and tell each other how we did.
You know, what's the next real big contest for you?
Probably the World Surfing Championships, the World Amateur Surfing Championships in Puerto Rico in February.
Who do you think the stiffest competition will come from?
Basically the Australians, because we did have a pretty tight battle with them in Australia, and we came up short and lost to them, so it's going to be pretty tough.
You know, you're a little bit larger than Kelly. Do you think he's going to catch up to you?
Hopefully I won't let that happen, but...
At the moment you can still push him around.
Yeah.
Kelly, you know, you're in the kind of age bracket lower than Sean is, you know, surfing in the juniors and that. Who's the strongest competition you find right now in the world of international amateur surfing?
It's hard to say, but there's a lot of good California kids.
You were saying you had like 4 or 5 years, you think, yet in amateur competition. So a stepping stone, you'd probably like to try and win the 1990, which seems so far away, World Men's Championship.
Yeah, I hope I do.
It's in Japan, I understand.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Do you think you're going to get much bigger? I mean, how old are you now? You're 15?
Yeah, I'm 15. I hope I start growing.
Do you think it's a disadvantage being smaller or bigger? I know you've been to Hawaii a couple of times. You actually spent some time with Ken Bradshaw.
Yeah. Well, I guess it's easier surfing in contests. You know, most of them are held in small waves, and I guess with my size, it's an advantage. But I got to grow to surf the bigger waves like Ken does.
What are the biggest waves you surf when you're in Hawaii?
Not that big, about, I don't know, hard to say.
Did you surf Sunset at all?
I went out there once.
It's pretty...
scary.
Well, at least you're a man to admit it.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for coming on the show, guys. We're glad you could make it all the way from Florida on your way back from Australia. And we'll be back in one moment.
Michigan, and I've watched every episode of Wave Watch. I just couldn't stand being away, so here I am, dudes.
And our regular From Hawaii sequence with Mark Fu.
Thanks a lot, Peter. Mark Fu here in Hawaii with our first ever local hero segment for Wave Watch. One of the towns in Hawaii that's always had a rich tradition of having local heroes is the town of Haleiwa and the surf spot of Haleiwa. With me today is the guy who would have to be considered the local hero in Haleiwa nowadays, Mr. Kerry Tarakina. How's it, Kerry? Thanks for being with us.
Thanks, Mark.
Okay, you know, Haleiwa has always been, it's an old-time surfing town. There's been, you know, it's a really a rich history there. You've seen the local heroes of the past. Who were the guys that were your heroes there at Haleiwa?
Well, when I first started out, the people that really impressed me the most was people like Howard Fisher, and 6 to 8 years down the line, you have a generation gap, and after that was Charlie Smith, Leonard Foster, then Marvin Foster took over for a while, and Jeff Kilborn, and Denton Miramura. Now we have me and Brock Little holding the fort right now, and down the line, could see guys like Matty Liu and Jason Megalin is coming up.
How come you got it so wired?
Local knowledge has a lot to do with it, and the best thing to do is just put your time in, punch in early, and put in several years behind you, and you have to really watch the older and more experienced people.
Well, it's easy for you. You've been living there your whole life. You lived across the street. I guess you're born and raised there. You've been surfing. How long have you been surfing Haleiwa now?
I'd say for about 12 years so far. Yeah.
And you check it every morning, no matter what?
Yeah, every morning I'm out there.
Who are some of the guys that have impressed you that have come over every year that have you know, been from overseas that have surfed well at Haleiwa?
By far the most impressive foreign surfer has to be Mark Richards. He knows the place really well, just as good as anybody else. And you have guys like Martin Potter's really coming on strong out there. And some of the Brazilians are doing really well out there the past couple of years. So slowly but surely, everybody's starting to get the place wired.
Do you feel, or do you find guys following you around and kind of tracking you, and you feel that sort of pressure out there?
Yeah, definitely. Most definitely. I think nowadays everybody knows pretty much well that if you want to get waves, you have to follow the local people that surf out there. So everybody's pretty much keying on me, but, you know, I get my waves. I get my share.
You've done very well in the Hawaiian Pro-Am circuit events in big waves and small waves. Why is it that you're not on the Pro Tour?
A big thing that has to deal with it is that I haven't really had very good sponsorship, but now everything's coming around with Blue Hawaii, and hopefully I'll get a good clothing sponsor and I'll get the financial backing to do that. And another thing that it's pretty much holding me back is my college education. I really want to get a real job.
So far we've just been talking about Haleiwa, and I don't want to portray as you being a very one-dimensional surfer, because you're real versatile and you surf a lot of other spots. Where else do you like to surf besides Haleiwa?
Another spot that's really underrated is a place called Laniakea, a couple miles, you know, further down north from Haleiwa.
In closing here, what do you want to do? How do you foresee your career?
As far as my pro surfing career, I could put in another couple of years into it, and then in the meantime attend college on part-time basis like I've been doing lately. But I'm really hoping for more financial backing from my sponsors. Everything's slowly unfolding for me.
A friend of mine in Michigan couldn't understand why I wanted to come to Southern California. I guess she hadn't seen the waves.
We're back here with Scott Dietrich, who's just come out with a great new film called Gone Surfing. And at the top of the show, of course, we saw a couple of waves from it. Welcome to the show, Scott.
Ah, thanks, Peter. Good to be here again.
Another new surf movie already. You're not wasting any time.
Nope. Last year when we came on the show, we said we'd not do any reruns and we'd have a whole new film out in 1 year. And here it is. September 26th is the opening, and that's 1 year and 1 week from last year's opening.
That's a big change from the old days of surf movie making. I mean, everyone used to like spend 2 or 3, 4 years, and by the time it really got to the screen, most of the action had happened 2 years ago at least. Is this the new way to go, you think?
Well, we think so. I mean, that's why we're doing it, of course. It's a big challenge for us. It requires a lot of different camera crews, but it keeps everything really up to date.
And, you know, does it put a lot of strain on you? I mean, you don't have the luxury of sitting around, I'm sure, for the perfect days like in the past. I mean, everybody kind of sat and waited for the perfect day. This is kind of, you get the good surfer and you go for it.
Well, you still have to wait around for the perfect day because that's what our audience expect. But what I've done is I've just increased the number of camera crews that are out there shooting. And, okay, a couple times you go and you don't get it and you don't even pull the trigger. You know it's not good enough quality. And fortunately, we had some pretty good luck. We had a good year on the North Shore. We'd gone to Fiji with Dane K. Aloha and John Dom and gotten the best 2 weeks that they've ever had in that island. And then we've gotten a number of other things. We've taken 4 trips to Baja.
How many movies have you made now? I mean, how
7.
Seven? After over a decade of making surf movies, it doesn't seem like it's made you a wealthy man.
No.
Is it getting any easier?
In some ways it's getting easier, but there's a heck of a lot of pressure because what we've tried to do, like I say, is we've got a lot more people working for us, and that makes it tough because the financial squeeze, there just isn't a lot of money in it. If I was doing it just to make money, I'd make regular Hollywood films. But
you love it too much.
I love it. It's to shoot surfing, when you get that classic day, there's nothing like it, and then take a lunch break and sneak out and catch a few waves myself.
Well, thanks for coming on the show and showing us the new Gone Surfing.
All right,
and,
thanks, Pete.
I'm sure everyone out there will be down to the theater to check it out. We're going to watch a couple more waves, and we'll be right back.
Baseball, but I love surfing and I love to watch Wave Watch.
We're back here with our new hot rookie out there on the ASP circuit, Todd Holland. He's come up through the amateur ranks, been in a number of world contests, and now he's out there having a crack at the big time in the Pro Tour. Welcome to the show, Todd.
Thanks. I've seen your show. It's really good.
You know, this is a big moment for you, of course, embarking on your pro career. You've been planning on that for a long time. You've already been out there and you've been in a few contests, and it seems to be going a little tough. Is it a little tougher than you expected?
Yeah, actually it is. It's totally different, because when you're working with your amateur career, you've worked your way up to the top, and then you're just dropped all the way back down to the bottom again. You're a nobody again.
You think it's tougher for a Florida guy than, say, a California kid?
Yes, I would say so, because in Florida, we've always been known for smaller waves and not so much of a good hard surfing from rail to rail.
You were saying earlier that you cracked your first session at Waimea this year. How was that?
quite an experience. As a matter of fact, I remember going over the falls and I thought I was going to die.
So what are your goals for this first year? You know, you've just got out there, you're just starting. What do you hope to attain by the end of the season?
Well, hopefully by the end of the season I can break into the top 30. I feel if I can break into the top 30 at least, then I'll be doing really good, because then you're seated in the background of the trials often.
Well, we wish you a lot of luck out there, and hopefully we'll see you in the top 30.
Thanks a lot.
Well, that's been another episode of Wave Watch. We hope you enjoyed it, and we'll be back with another great show soon.